spill.
This looks ridiculous.
That's my best friend, Ryan.
I want to be angry.
And his crazy old man, Poppy.
I think I just made Mother Nature my bitch.
When we're off the clock, we're on a mission.
We have a deadline. Let's get fired up.
To outsmart Mother Nature.
Come on, Wind.
And take on the chaos she creates for folks around town.
Holy cow.
A front's coming in.
With a little junk.
Look what I found.
And a whole lot of ingenuity.
This is great.
It's almost like we planned it.
There's no problem we can't solve. This is Brainstormers.
Ready?
It's not snow. Man, water's leaking like crazy.
I don't think you got any air.
Nothing.
I think that hose is frozen.
I bet you're wondering what's going on here. Well, let me catch you up.
So, where are we going?
You ever been to Ruby Hill?
I don't believe so.
Do you know the name Seth Hill?
The snowboarder.
Yeah, the professional snowboarder.
He called us?
Yes, he did. He reached out to us and said, hey guys, I got a project, I think you're gonna like it. Can you help me out? And I said, well, heck yeah.
I can't believe we're meeting up with a world-class snowboarder, but it's barely mid-October, and with these spring-like temperatures, snowboarding season doesn't start for quite some time. I'm kind of curious to see what Seth has in mind.
Oh, he's doing stunts over here?
Of course, never sitting still.
Winter sports are a huge part of Colorado culture. And snowboarders like Seth Hill, well, they're bona fide rock stars around here.
Excuse me, this is a no skateboarding area, sir.
Sorry, my bad.
How's it going?
Good, how are you guys?
Good.
Thanks for coming out.
Hey, Ryan?
Sure, Ryan, Seth, nice to meet you guys.
Tells me you guys have spoken.
Yes.
He wanted us to help you, and that's all he told me.
Yeah, broke my back a few months ago here.
Jeez.
I've been staying strong, you know, trying to rehab and whatnot. But I got the approval from the doctor, and I'm ready to be on snow. And so I'd like your help in making that happen.
So what do we need to do for you?
We're gonna make some snow. Like soon. I want my own little portable snowmaker. I can't really imagine renting it and how much time and effort and cost and stuff like that's gonna take, so. Wanted to throw them a little challenge and see if they could make me what I needed.
I told you this project was going to be cool. Literally.
Cool.
I wish I could share in Ryan's enthusiasm right now, but making snow is very complex, even under the best conditions. Natural snow forms when clouds containing tiny water droplets rise into the cooler layers of the atmosphere. Once the cloud temperature dips to about 14 degrees Fahrenheit, the water droplets freeze. And when those tiny ice crystals collide, they form those complex structures we call snowflakes. Unfortunately, it's not as easy to whip up a batch of the white stuff at ground level unless all the conditions are ideal. And with Colorado's unpredictable weather, well, that could be tomorrow or a month from now.
It's gonna be fun. I mean, we gotta do something completely different than we've ever done before in that sense.
Yeah.
I mean, we're bringing the weather to you.
Correct.
So you need to talk to Poppy, or are you good? You wanna do this?
I want to do this. If it can be done, we're your guys.
Yeah, nice.
We have to build a portable snow machine for Seth so he can have his own personal snowstorm wherever he goes.
Nice.
Before snowmaking, ski resorts had to rely on Mother Nature. But in 1949, Walter Schoeneck, who owned a ski resort in Connecticut, took matters into his own hand. He brought in over 700 tons of ice, had it chopped up and spread all over a single slope. That was the first known use of fake snow on a ski slope.
It worked okay, but it didn't quite do the trick. It definitely sparked an idea, though, because later that year,
Wayne Pierce, along with his two partners, Arthur Hunt and Dave Ritchie, rigged up a spray gun, a 10-horsepower compressor, and a garden hose. They experimented with their DIY snow gun all night. And by morning, they had about 20 inches of snow. We're gonna take that same simple concept and use it as the foundation for our snowmaker. In true Colorado fashion, we went from short sleeves to turtlenecks overnight, thanks to a cold front. But it's actually the perfect weather to get started on Seth Hill's snow machine, so we're gonna head to one of our favorite scrap yards to see if we can repurpose some parts.
I love the smell of junkyards in the morning.
Hey, how you guys doing?
Good, how are you?
Good to see you.
You too.
What could you possibly be working on today?
Oh, one of them trucks of mine, you know. What are you guys up to?
The usual.
Okay, come and pick through some stuff, see if you can find anything good.
Yeah.
Well, have at it.
Sweet.
Oh, man.
See you later.
Thanks, John.
Snowmakers come in two basic designs, the fan gun or the nozzle. Fan guns are the commercial-grade snow cannons you see dotting the hillsides in all these major ski areas. They can produce massive amounts of snow, but they also use a lot of electricity and are pretty pricey to operate. On the other hand, the nozzle base, they produce less snow, but they're also less expensive and a lot more portable. So we decided this design would be best for Seth.
All right.
So we're looking for what particular as far as the tanks?
Nothing bigger than 20 gallon, I would think, so we can still move around.
Power washers, sprayers, nozzles, that kind of thing, right?
The nozzle design uses specialty components to spray large amounts of pressurized water and compressed air. But we don't have those custom parts, so we're hoping we can achieve those same results by repurposing an ordinary pressure washer and a basic air compressor. Now, we just gotta find them.
So divide and conquer?
Done.
All right. Who paints a motor gold?
Gold motor.
Look at this.
This is awesome.
For blood
only. For blood only.
Know how to trash can.
This is great. This is good.
Holy smokes. Look at this. I need these. Yes, sir.
Hey, Bill, you know you get to a certain age when you realize that you need handicap accessible handles on your shower walls.
No, he wants those on the side of the truck so he can get in and out of the truck. We've not gone 2 minutes and we're no longer focused on the snow machine. What happened?
Ooh, a razor.
Focus, Father, focus.
I'm trying. I'm looking at all this stuff.
Power washer. Holy crap. 6 horsepower, 2 gallons per minute, 2,000 PSI. We need more than 1,200. Hey, Bill, this is what we need right here.
Wow.
2.0?
Yeah, 6 horsepower, 2,000 PSI.
Made in America. Bet you love that.
Assuming this thing even works, we need to produce enough volume of water per minute and enough pressure per square inch to get the spray out as far as possible.
Nice find, Ryan.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, now we've got to find a portable air compressor, because without it, that pressure washer, it's useless. It uses a motor to suck air into a reinforced tank and store it at a very high pressure. When that air is discharged, it's super cold, and that's exactly what we need to make our precious little snowflakes.
The tank right over there.
Nope. Nothing here.
And nothing.
How about piping, Dad?
Yeah, we need some piping. Like this, if there's enough of it. You can put the nozzles up to get the height.
Let's put it out here.
All right.
Ryan! Right here!
Oh, my God.
Maybe he found some heat.
It's really old.
Oh, man.
What is it?
Dude!
I don't even know if that's going to work.
What do you think?
Yeah.
It looks really, really solid.
I think it's a good find.
Then awesome. Let's get the heck out of here.
Good job!
Overall, it was a pretty decent pick. I'm just kind of excited to get back to the shop and see if we can get all this stuff running. Otherwise, we just bought ourselves some very expensive paperweights.
I get a new ice scraper.
Oh, that's ridiculous. I can't believe how many of these she breaks in a year. I'm gonna make you something you can't break. Oh, yeah.
Oh, you gotta be kidding me.
What?
There's a giant hole underneath it.
Sun. It's nice.
Ryan and I are grabbing a few more things for Seth Hill's snowmaker project. It's only October, though, so we're really hoping Mother Nature cooperates.
Oh, no, Ryan.
What?
What's your dad doing?
Oh, is he chopping wood with his bad knee?
No. Let's go help him now so we don't have to bring him to the emergency room.
Yay. Poppy just had knee surgery, and I've been on him about being careful. This is the exact thing he should not be doing. Pop, what are you doing?
What's the matter?
If you need help chopping wood, I've got no problem volunteering Ryan's time. You know that.
No, I didn't, Bill. Thank you so
you
much
go.
For that. Well, the weather's a little warmer. It doesn't kind of hurt as bad. So I'm just trying to get some done before the snow comes.
Oh, my dad, he's proud and stubborn. Even if I stop him from chopping wood now, he'll be back here later doing the same thing.
I want to keep you around for a little while longer, and I want you to be mobile.
The only solution is to come up with a safer way for him to do this.
I've got a few ideas.
You know, I won't turn that down.
Come on. Let's go figure this out. Okay, so, Dad, what do you want out of here?
You want to split wood, right?
It's painful for me to be cutting down the trees I planted as a young boy.
You know what?
So, what are you building this thing out of? Hydraulics?
Yeah, just looking up LogSplitter gives us tons and tons of options. Looks like some are gas-powered, 27-ton hydraulic LogSplitters.
Wow, that's a lot.
Yeah, that's a lot of log. Most of them have some sort of hydraulic ram.
So you got the ram here that's literally pushing the log.
Hydraulic rams, though, I mean...
They're not cheap.
Yeah.
Hydraulic rams are the basic building blocks for commercial log splitters. And depending on how much pressure per square inch they can crush, they can range anywhere from $300 to $3,000. But I think I might have a workaround using some old parts we've got lying around the shop.
That's funny, man.
You gonna work on a truck now? What are you doing?
Essentially, all that's underneath here is a hydraulic ram, right there. It's the same thing, though. That's what that ram is right there, is that ram.
Oh, okay. If I'm understanding what you're saying, log goes here, and then at the top of this box, we've got like a cage, and then there's a axe head or a wedge. And basically, when we're lifting this up, it splits the log.
Okay. That makes sense, yeah.
Yeah, no, let's give it a whirl.
We can use this?
Yeah, absolutely.
Padre, you can do this.
Yeah, I think it'll work, guys. I'm willing to put this together and see how it turns out.
We got this.
Not to pat myself on the back, but repurposing that car jack for the ram, well, that was huge. Now all we have to do is rummage through Padre's shop to find some steel to build the frame and a blade to split that wood. Winter is clearly on its way here in Colorado, but it won't be anything like the storm of the century. Back in March of 1993, it hit the eastern seaboard, stretching from Cuba to Canada. It was a unique combination of a cyclone and a blizzard, which caused over $2 billion in property damage alone. This storm was not only huge, but it dropped snow in places that rarely experience it. Even parts of Florida got significant amounts of snow. And Birmingham, Alabama received 17.7 inches. And they only average about an inch and a half every season. Despite the destruction, the storm actually marked a milestone in United States weather forecasting.
Drifts certainly could be anywhere from 8 to 12 feet.
Because it was the first time meteorologists were able to use computer technology to predict how severe a storm would be 5 days in advance.
Well, let's get started on this and see if our idea on the board is as good in reality. Let's get cracking on the welding.
Okay. Poppy found us a good stash of steel pipes and sheet metal that we're gonna use to weld a frame around the car jack. And we also have a wedge that we're gonna weld to the frame, and hopefully that thing will cut through wood like dentures cut through oatmeal.
We gotta grind where these corners go. Ryan has to take a die grinder and grind the four corners of the sheet metal to get the impurities off of it so that he can weld the four legs on. If you don't do this, you leave impurities in the metal, and it causes weak welds. Good. You hold it like that?
Got it.
All right.
That's right on the money, honey.
I'm gonna put one right there, and we'll do the other side, okay?
Okay.
When welding with direct current, or DC, the metal has to be clean. The current travels in one direction. When you're using alternating current, or AC, the electricity travels in both directions. It has a gouging cleaning motion, and the steel doesn't have to be as clean, but it's not structurally as strong as using a DC weld. Beauteous! All right, Bill, get on the jack. Okay, pump the handle a couple times, Billy. Get her all the way up there.
Wow.
All right, now we're gonna put this right here. Now, where's the wedge? Look at that. I think that'll work, huh? Put a mark on there.
All right, it's gonna get noisy. Come on. The blade is flexing, Dad.
You want me to do it? Don't push so hard.
Okay.
Ryan's using a chop saw to cut a steel beam. If you push too hard using the blade, one, you can break it, but two, you build up too much heat and you don't let the blade do its job. Just don't push so hard.
Look at you!
Okay, we ready to put it all together?
Yeah, that's...
You're good. Yeah, the frames are looking really solid.
The last thing we need to do is add the wedge for the big test. Or will it chop?
Let's just try it. Let's just try it, all right?
Okay, you ready?
Yeah.
It's loud.
Oh!
Are we torquing on the, yep. the wedge? It's gonna bust it.
Whoa, whoa, whoa!
We finally finished the log splitter we drummed up with Poppy.
Oh!
Now it's time to see if this thing can deliver so my old man can finally hang up his axe. Preferably before he has a swing and a miss and takes out his other knee.
I think we've maxed it out here.
Oh, you're going too much at an angle now.
Yeah, it's gonna bust it.
We built this just to hang stumps off of, huh?
Well, let me grab some stuff. There's gotta be some parts around here, something. Hmm. My dad taught me everything I know. There's no way I'm dropping the ball on this project. I think the problem is our jack isn't getting the log high enough so the wedge penetrates the log deep enough to split the wood apart.
So let's layer this like an onion.
Once we get the proper height, this should be good to go. No, let's give it a whirl.
Yes or no?
Coming up. Watch your face. Okay, something ain't right.
Okay, so we found a problem with it, didn't we?
Yeah.
As much as I want to spoon feed them the answers on how to fix this, there's no better experience than them figuring it out on their own. There's no greater teacher than complete and utter failure. And it seems like right now, we got plenty of that to go around.
Plan B.
Copy. I'm starting to get ticked off. I'm really disappointed. The first thing I go to build for my dad is turning into an epic fail. Yep. But we still need to get started on Seth Hill's Snowmaker. So we're gonna put this on the back burner and take another look at it when we've got fresh eyes.
Doesn't look too horrible, Ryan.
We're finally getting started on building a portable snow machine for professional snowboarder Seth Hill.
We're gonna make some snow.
What kind of shape is that in?
The bones are good, but just wasn't treated very well.
There's no telling what might be wrong with the parts that we salvaged from the junkyard. So now the trick is getting them to run properly.
Oh, you got to be kidding me.
What? There's a giant hole underneath it.
That's not gonna hold air too well.
Wait, eh? I cleaned up the compressor, and I just noticed a nice little hole that's been painted and patched just lying there in the dirt. We need this air compressor to reach 100 pounds per square inch of pressure to properly supercool the mist. But I just don't feel comfortable using a tank that's already being compromised at that high a pressure. So, safety first.
What are you working on?
Dad, this thing is a lot more problematic than I realized. This had a big hole on the bottom. Bigger issue than it's worth.
Well, I think I can help you here.
Okay.
Several years ago, I reconditioned another one I found in a scrapyard.
Yeah.
I got an old portable one sitting back there.
You're seriously willing to part with this?
Yeah, I don't use it that often. Right over there. I think Ryan gets his love for tinkering from me. So if something I cobble together gets him out of a jam, I'm really happy to see it get put to good use. See, that's easier to move.
Yeah, this thing's great.
Oh, wow.
My dad's Frankenstein air compressor isn't gonna win any beauty contest, but if we can make it work, he just saved our butts. I saw over here you have something. What do you got?
Oh, well, you know, I had this from last summer and it broke. This old sprinkler thing. We could stand this up like a little tripod. You guys could hook your nozzle on this. We take that sprinkler head off.
Using this as a stand would be awesome.
Yeah.
Lightweight, portable, Seth's gonna like that.
Yeah. We got three moving pieces, basically. Air compressor, power washer, and stand.
Yeah.
Looks like you have a whole lot of fun going on over there.
I'm glad we have all of our components in place, but getting them to function all together to make snow, that's another story.
What'd you buy me?
I get a new ice scraper.
Didn't you just buy one of those?
Yeah, I broke that one this morning.
I can't believe how many of these she breaks in a year.
Yeah, I've broke a couple of them.
Oh, that's ridiculous. What'd that cost?
$10, $11. $11.95.
You know, I could build 5 or 6 of those for that price.
Well, you haven't yet.
You know, I've never built an ice scraper before, but it can't be that hard. I'm gonna make you something you can't break.
Mima's windshield isn't the only victim of icy conditions. In the 1940s, the U.S. started using rock salt on our icy roads because the salt dissolves and it lowers the freezing point of water, making it harder for ice to form. These days, 10 to 20 million tons of salt are spread on the roads each year, and the U.S. is the second largest producer of salt on this planet. Mining salt is a massive operation. Salt miners work hundreds to thousands of feet below the surface of the earth, drilling and blasting salt deposits. Once the salt is extracted from the mine, it can be crushed to whatever size is desired and then shipped out. Some salt will end up on the street, and some salt will end up in your dinner. Are you ready to operate?
Yep.
You're closed?
We are indeed.
Plug it in.
Copy, Poppy.
And switch on?
Well, we hit a couple of roadblocks while working on a log splitter for Poppy. So, well, that's on standby. We're working on the snowmaker we're building for a pro snowboarder, Seth Hill.
Okay. Yep.
Whoa! We have air.
20. Bill. How high do we have to go for the snow pressure?
100 PSI?
Yeah.
We'll need at least 100 pounds per square inch of pressure to properly freeze the volume of water that we'll be spraying. So hopefully Poppy's homemade compressor will do the trick.
All right, what did we shut off at? Nice.
125.
Perfect, that's exactly what we need.
Got those two.
Don't do that. But that's dangerous, you could cut somebody's skin with that. Strike a pose, Fabio.
It's like a photo shoot.
Okay, enough.
How's it going, nozzle boy?
I'll show you a nozzle. Now we're finally getting to the third and most important piece of this puzzle, the nozzle assembly. These pieces were only $5 a pop, but it's impossible to make snow without them. Part of this assembly will house misting nozzles, which are used to spray the high pressure water into a large cloud. But the key to snowmaking is the nucleation nozzle, which introduces freezing air into the mix.
Nice and tight. That's as good and tight.
The compressed air helps transform water into snow in two ways. First off, as the high-pressure air shoots out, the force blasts into the mist and atomizes the water droplets into even smaller water particles, making them much easier to cool. While that's happening, the compressed air also loses kinetic energy in the form of heat as it's shot out of the nozzle. As the supercooled air passes over each water molecule, it evaporates the surface layer, absorbing heat from the water and drastically lowering its temperature. If the temperature and humidity are just right, the water particle will form into an ice crystal, the basic building block of a snowflake.
So far, so good, huh? Not too shabby.
We're gonna zip tie that to that, or do you wanna put it up higher?
Oh, that's a fantastic question.
Are you gonna hold it and just be the man?
Yeah, like you did when you held the lantern on that horse saying, the redcoats are coming, the redcoats are coming.
No, that wasn't me.
Wasn't you?
No, I was in the tower waving the lamp. That's too far to ride in the dark, man. Where do you want this one? That's right here?
Yep, that'll work. And we'll be ready to go.
Cool. That is high class, guys.
I'm telling you.
Huh?
Now that everything's running right, the only thing left to do is rig this thing up outside so we can test this puppy out when it's cold enough.
Theoretically, the air compressor's going to be providing us air into this bottom nozzle here. The water's going to come in. It's gonna go in here, go out of these three nozzles, and then we just slowly crack this little valve right here to allow some of this air to come up and hit that water and just atomize it and blast it.
Till we get the mixture we want.
Yep.
Cool.
Yeah.
So while we're waiting for the temperature to drop, we have plenty of other fish to fry.
We need a redo.
What?
The LogSplitter.
Yeah.
That thing was a failure.
We wanted to save Poppy from ruining his bionic knee, so we built the LogSplitter out of scrap steel and a hydraulic floor jack. It didn't work out so well.
Stupid.
But failure is just a stop on the road to success.
I've got an idea with regard to an old cherry picker. And I need engine hoist.
Yeah.
Cherry pickers are normally used for putting engines in vehicles.
But I think we might be able to repurpose an old one we salvaged to chop wood.
You really want to use that?
Yeah, I think it's perfect.
Dude, if your dad thought it was junk, it's probably junk.
Well, it's not really junk. It got a little beat up. Holy we haven't cow. Needed to put an engine in for a while. Yeah, I think it's perfect.
So Ryan's idea is to modify a cherry picker. Now it's a whole lot taller and a lot heavier than a car jack, so that when the arm swings down, the gravity should provide enough force that it can split through even the thickest of logs.
You've got this. It's a 2-ton jack, so it's rated for 4,000 pounds. But we create a lever out here with a handle on it.
You just kind of boop, and it pops back
Correct.
Up.
The weight of this coming down
yeah.
is going to split that wood.
But then we need something to bring it back up.
Exactly.
This, okay.
The cherry picker arm has a lot of weight to it, and we don't want Padre to get a hernia on top of his knee problems. So we need to put in some sort of spring system so it's easier to reset the arm after each swing.
Let me go check outside. I'm not seeing anything in here. You gotta be kidding me. Awesome. Look what I found. Dude, 2 years ago, I was working on a project, totally forgot about this. That's what we need right there.
Yeah, I can just coil that down.
Uh-huh.
Oh, this is gonna be awesome.
Yeah.
Wow. Nice.
So I will straighten out this so it goes in the hole.
Ryan needs to straighten out the end of the spring that he found so it'll fit inside the frame of the log splitter that we're making.
Hold. All right, so this guy goes in here.
He's dropping the post. See if this has to be level.
It's bent. Oh, so I need to literally drop it here and then turn this up.
If you just do that while this is on, actually, we can just use this to kind of bend it around.
Okay. All right, start to add a little pressure to that.
Yeah, nice, nice. That's straight right there.
You good?
Damn, that was nice, dude.
Are you blessing it? What do you think my father's gonna say?
That we did it wrong?
We need to weld on a pin to keep the spring and the post from buckling.
If we just kind of weld that on there, that'll keep that from kicking back.
That's awesome.
I want to weld.
Okay. Woo, that was close. Damn near took my head off. That's holding pretty well. I think this part is solid. That's yeah. fantastic. Yep. Then we need to figure out the distance or the length of this rod, yeah. and the axe head is going to be the last thing we put on.
I'm working on sharpening the actual blade to split the wood.
Woo-hoo. Look at that, that's cool.
Is this your dad's wallet?
Let's weld up the head and we're done.
All right, bro.
That's nice, that's very nice.
Ready?
Made it.
Got yep. that in?
Yep.
Boom.
Okay.
Okay. That is good and tight.
Cool. You ready?
Oh. And it's time to test this baby.
You think the block will break or the table?
Yep.
Ready?
Yeah!
Yeah!
Holy crap, that was awesome.
That's fantastic.
I am so stoked about this. Of course, the real test will be to see how it works for Padre. We should go get Padre.
Yeah, just move your finger. Hey, let me get you another piece.
We are at awesome snowmaking temperature here. We really had to jump on this because this might be our only shot.
We good?
Come on, baby.
Close your eyes, Poppy.
All right. I am so stoked about this. Of course, the real test will be to see how it works for Padre.
You ready?
Straight down.
I told Meemaw that I could build her an ice scraper a lot cheaper and stronger than those plastic toothpicks she's been going through. So now, I gotta put my skills where my mouth is. I gotta find some plastic that's strong enough that she just can't snap it. That's too thin. I know I got a sheet somewhere. That's what I want. That's much heavier. Luckily, I found a piece of Lexan lying around. It's a polycarbonate known for its impact resistance and stability. I mean, this stuff is so strong that some banks actually use it as an alternative to bulletproof glass. Okay, I gotta find something for a handle. What have I got? She's not doing a little car, she's doing her trucks. Ooh, gotta have at least a 2-foot handle on it so she can get across the windshield. That's too big for me, Ma. I need something smaller in diameter. It's too thick. I got different kinds of wood material. Found a piece of OSB that was like 3/8 thick. Trim this up. Ripped it on the bandsaw. Wish I had a way to hold these two together. Ooh, I think that's gonna work. Drilled some holes while I had it in a vise. Sanded it all down. It's done. I pushed on it. There's no way she's gonna break that cleaning windows. Oh, that's a good scraper. We'll see what Cindy thinks.
What's she got there?
Break that.
Holy cow, you didn't make that.
The hell I didn't.
Yeah, you did. I recognized the OSB board.
That's all I had.
What'd it cost you?
About $1.50. What'd that cost you, 12?
Here, you can take this one back.
Do I want to take it back to the store? She bought it.
You keep the change.
If I get to keep the change?
Yeah, I don't think I'm gonna be breaking this.
I don't only like put 12 bucks in my pocket, but I'm probably saving 30, 40 bucks a year by not having her go to the store and keep replacing them.
We'll see you for dinner.
Okay.
We are at awesome, awesome snowmaking temperature here.
What's the temp?
It's down to 14 degrees.
Oh, fantastic.
Luckily, we're in a cold snap, so it's the perfect time to test out the snow machine that we're making for our pro snowboarder friend, Seth Hill. We really had to jump on this because with Colorado's bipolar temperature swings, this might be our only shot. The only thing I'm worried about is Padre's garden hose out there. Is that...
It'll work.
What's that?
It'll work.
When it gets this cold, water can freeze inside the hose and plug it up.
It'll work.
The hose, even if it's...
Yeah, I always drain the hose out when I get done using them.
All right, that's what I've read about you.
I hope the old man's right, because no water, no snow.
Just to be sure, are you good?
No, I think it's good.
Does yeah,
it
okay.
You right here.
Well, on that note, I've got nothing to worry about.
Let's see if this thing fires up.
That thing's smooth.
It's electric.
We've got our hose ready. We've got the air compressor, which looks hell of a lot better now that I painted it mean green.
Woo! Making air.
Of course, we have our trusty pressure washer, which in these frigid conditions is acting a little less than trusty.
Let me hold that.
No, little pump was frozen down there.
If you don't start, I will throw you right back in that trash heap and you will never see me again.
Perfect.
You ready for water?
Yes, sir. Thank you. Padre turns on the water. We got some good air.
Ryan connects the air.
We got good air.
And I plug the hoses into the nozzles.
We good?
Trying to get the water to come through here. That might be frozen too.
What we should be seeing is a fine mist shooting out of the nozzle and crystallizing in the air. But what we're actually seeing is nada. Zilch. Nothing. So we've got to figure out where the water is getting stopped up.
Was there water coming out there?
There's tons of water coming out of here.
We've got to track down the water blockage. If the water hose is icing up, you'll hear a crunching sound if you try to bend it. And of course, it'll be harder to flex if there's any sections that are frozen solid.
Shut it down.
Okay.
There's one little spot in the hose. It's got a chunk of ice.
Ah, all right.
You want the other hose?
All right, let's try the other one.
It was a pretty night, though, to be out here playing with our hoses.
You ready? Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo! It's gonna be awesome!
We got air?
That's not snow. Man, water's leaking like crazy.
I don't think you got any air.
Nothing.
The problem we're having is this thing's frozen here. There's ice in here.
If they're frozen, we gotta blow all those other valves out.
One of the hose fittings got brittle from the cold and cracked. So now the leaky water is freezing the nozzle underneath it, plugging it up with ice, and the compressed air can't get through. So I'm gonna crank up the water pressure while Ryan increases the air pressure to see if we can blow the ice out of the nozzle and let it snow, let it snow, let it snow.
Yep.
Pumping up the pressure blew the ice right out of the nozzle, but it's still spraying water everywhere. And to prevent it from freezing again, we're gonna have to fix that leak.
So what we can do real quickly if we want, just directly connect those two together real quick, and then that won't leak, this will blow out, and we'll be good.
Let's do it.
So this will come out.
Okay, that one's off.
The nozzles have rubber washers on the tips, but it's not a perfect seal, so we're gonna have to take them off.
We're just gonna direct connect it right in there. Boom, can't leak.
Let's try it.
Yeah?
Hopefully everything hasn't frozen already.
Thank you, good girl.
Wow.
Wow.
You know what?
That's snow. We made snow.
Woo! Nice job, high five.
Holy cow.
Good job, Dad.
It's starting to stick.
We can make snow angels. Woo!
Oh, no.
We made this. We did this. We should probably wait until it's a little deeper.
We're making a lot of snow here, but not nearly as much as Mother Nature can dish out when she really wants to. A blizzard can create a massive amount of snow, stop traffic, and tear down power lines. But what makes a blizzard? And how do weather experts know when to call a snowstorm a blizzard? Let's see how much you know about the biggest winter storms. What makes a winter storm a blizzard? Is it A, damage done to homes? B, temperatures below 0 degrees Fahrenheit? C, low visibility and high winds, or D, the arrival of Santa Claus? We'll have the answer and more when we come back. Let's get back to my question. What makes a winter storm a blizzard? The answer is C, high winds and low visibility. If a snowstorm has 3 or more hours of wind over 35 miles per hour, making visibility less than a quarter of a mile, you've got a blizzard. When nature doesn't bring snow, ski hills will use snowmakers like ours to create snow for their mountains. Their models are a little more heavy duty than ours, but the principle's still the same.
We're on our way to deliver the snowmaker to Seth Hill. One little problem though, it's a sunny 40 degrees and that's not cold enough to make snow. What little white stuff is on the ground is melting fast.
Oh, holy cow. If we don't have enough snow, we'll have enough goose poo. That's pretty slippery.
Uh-oh, Seth is already here. Yeah.
Nice.
How's your back?
Feel good as new.
Yeah.
Man, awesome. Thanks, guys.
Dude, that was good.
Sweet.
That was gnarly.
Yeah, gnarly. Yeah. So the guys brought me an artificial snow invention, basically.
You commissioned us to have a snowmaker, and we do.
Okay.
And it works, and it's awesome. We did some tests, produced snow. However, not a whole lot of snow can be produced when it's as warm as it is now. Want to check it out?
Yeah, let's do this.
Right over here. So.
So. Which one's the snowmaker?
No, snowmaker's over there. We're just getting ready to do some washing here.
Oh, okay.
No, this, we got an old pressure washer here that we found on a picking trip.
All right.
We got one of Padre's old air compressors. He's had that in the family for 20 some odd years.
Oh, yeah.
Those pipe into this valve system that is actually being supported by another one of Padre's finds there, an old sprinkler system that he had. It combined pressurized water with the pressurized air mixed together in this little valve right here. You just crack it just a bit, and they come out here and it turns the water into a fine mist, and it's small enough that it atomizes and actually creates snowflakes. And it can actually put out a, well,
What was the pattern this could do?
I think 8 by 20, but when we ran it the other day, it was more like 20 by 40. It was amazing what it was putting out.
Pretty awesome.
You asked for mobility.
Yep.
And basically, it's something that's really easy. You can put it in your car, take it wherever you want to go.
I like it. It's flashy. It's like our style, you know? Definitely a shame that we can't, you know, put their invention to work here.
The nice thing is that if you want real snow and the weather's cold enough, you can make snow now.
Pretty awesome. Good news is the snowmaker was made. That's pretty sweet to actually see that they produced what I wanted and needed, and they made something out of some other pieces of like used stuff. That's awesome. It's super fun. I'm excited to play around in this thing. I think it's gonna come in handy.
Awesome.
Knowing Seth's happy with his snowmaker totally made our day, but it's not over yet. Now we're back at the ranch, and it's finally time to see what Poppy thinks about the new log splitter we built him.
Okay, that is good and tight.
You ready?
Oh, yes.
Let's put some wood under this.
I want to cut some wood.
It's all set up. Now it's time to show it to Padre. Ryan and I think it's some of our finest work, but the old man always finds something to complain about.
Close your eyes, Poppy. Close your eyes. Keep them closed.
The heck do you guys do?
Keep them closed. Come on. All right. All right. Yeah. All right. Your eyes open?
Yeah.
Ta-da!
Oh, my God. Is that my old cherry picker?
Yes, it is.
Is it okay?
I don't know. What'd you do to it?
Well, that was one of our concerns. I mean, come check this out.
I went and looked, and I was really surprised. They did a great job. That's amazing.
We did a project a couple years ago on a friend's car. We had a leftover spring in the back. So I heated it up, bent it, and we were able to fit the whole thing in there.
That's brilliant engineering,
and
guys.
And you could just literally just unscrew the thing.
Oh. Check this out. While you were gone,
we
used the grinder, we used the flapper disc, we used the cutting tool, we used the torch, and some various vice grips. You taught us well, Padre.
Let me see. Put your hands up in the air. Let me count your fingers.
Well, don't count the thumb.
Gosh, you guys did all right.
Check this out. This is the coolest part. Now, you want to give it a shot?
Just slam it down?
Yeah.
Ready?
Heck yeah. Straight down.
For
one piece of wood, there was two.
The nice thing is, you don't have to swing an axe. You're not picking anything up.
Do it again.
Look at that.
Yeah.
You know what? You guys just built yourself the best log splitter. I really can't believe how well this thing works. They completely re-engineered the design and made something hard, effortless. My old bones and my fireplace are gonna be very happy. You did such a great job, you should have the privilege of cutting this wood. And with two of you, it shouldn't take you no time at all.
I thought the purpose of building this was so you could cut the wood.
Don't make a mess. Clean it up when you're done. Thank you. Great job, guys, really.
You're kidding, right?
Well,
I'll go grab the rest of the wood.
I'm gonna stand here and stare at this. 'Cause it's awesome!